We're back here at the Guggenheim and entering into our final session of the day. We are looking now into something a little bit more like field research. We're looking and talking to researcher and writer Elizabeth Hoover, whose practice is related to food sovereignty and raising issues related to the relationship between land, history, people, and place. We're talking about the activities and activism related to pipelines that are affecting food sovereignty and systems across the Americas. And we will be also following Elizabeth, talking to the artist Carolina Caycedo and David de Rozas. We will be meeting these people in Texas, where they have an exhibition, and we'll be learning all about the relationship between infrastructure, history, land, and place. I'm really excited about these films, and I think that you will find them super stimulating as well. And I'm so glad that we have Macarena Gomez Barris, who is an academic at Pratt Institute here in Brooklyn, and she's also the author of a book called Extractive Geographies. She's going to do a great job in moderating the conversation between Carolina and Elizabeth. I really hope you're enjoying the day, and I hope that you're able to engage online with us too.
My name is Carolina Caycedo. I am a visual artist.
My name is David de Rozas. I'm a filmmaker and visual artist.
We are at the Visual Arts Center at UT Austin in our show that just opened called The Blessings of the Mystery. We started working on it 3 years ago when we got invited by folks at Ballroom Marfa. Here in Texas, we know that the major industries related to land have been historically cattle, and the oil industry, and even the prison industrial complex industries.
We were struck because we were surrounded by fences all the time, and then we learned that 95% of Texas is owned by private individuals.
I think fences and damming infrastructures are part of a similar ideology, something that we call brute force infrastructures. They are, you know, monumental, they're huge infrastructures, they're imposed. It makes me think that the border fences are brute force infrastructures too. And so this body of work are all triangulated in three locations in West Texas, which is the McDonald Observatory, the Amistad Dam on the Rio Grande, and the Permian Basin oil fields. Between these three is the largest repository of rock art in the United States.
The Permian Basin is like the biggest oil field in the United States, a location that precisely speaks about this natural devastation. If you look it from like Google Earth or satellite images, it looks like an immense area that has been kind of like a bomb. And we wonder also for how long this ecological devastation will take the land to heal.
This is a whole new body of work. Sculpture with vintage and contemporary survey tools, survey flags, drawings made of fence patterns of Texas. You know, what we want to be as critical about instruments like surveying, like map making, in relationship to the process of westward expansion.
Some people think of the westward expansion as a process that was like a more like a free in a way that like people basically like took lands, and it wasn't like that. It was a pretty like meditative and methodological process where like lands were like surveyed in advance, privatized, and then like sold.
You know, oil industry and the construction of pipelines, the construction of the borderline, even water infrastructures today are a continuation of colonial processes and land privatization. The exhibition and the film proposes that we start being more critical about cartography as it has been used until today. Mapping, surveying are instrumental to languages of violence that we have been discussing. So map making is not this kind of free of guilt process, right? We have to be critical about it, though it has been a way to construct knowledge and to understand places better. It is not free of guilt. It has come hand in hand with other forms of violence. The map is like a perfect example of a colonizing gaze, right? oh, we're trying to understand everything and everything is clear here for you. There's nothing else to understand.
Like an interesting tool to create like a knowledge, of course, but also like a counter geographies that break that flat understanding of the land.
It's not only about mapping the land as we know it, but, you know, all those aspects that build up, you know, our kind of connection to the more universal core to the earth connections, and trying to see how the indigenous and native people of here understand those connections. How do the indigenous people of this region call the rivers, call the mountains, call the region?
Juan Mancias, who is the chairman of the Carrizo Come Crudo tribe, is the main voice and even like the spine in the film.
My name is Juan Mancias, and we're the place we call Somisec Village.
For the Carrizo, it's not Texas, it's Somisec. The changing of names into names that are the language of the colonizer, right? That's a, you know, verbal aggression.
It's all part of taking over the land and utilizing the land, and it continues to promote the fossil fuel corporations that are not human. What do we consider as the critical infrastructure? It's the air, the water, the land, and the human beings. We choose not to recognize the fact that we are part of this earth. Racism is not just about the color of being white, but it's also now about being colonized. How much you've become colonized to that mentality.
We have been complicit with that colonizer gaze through this format that we call landscape, right? If you think about the landscape, it's this window through which, as humans, we look at something. We're outside of that nature.
The West was portrayed in the US by paint and photography, as well as cinema, as like an immense, vast, empty space.
If we continue to build landscapes and think in landscape terms, we're just prolonging the colonizer gaze, and it's time that we actually backtrack on that and decompose it. I think it's important for us, if we like are really serious about decolonizing, is like understanding what are the ways of map making, where subjectivities are present, where rituals are present, where spirituality is present. How can we decompose what we know as mapping today and bring it as an instrument for decolonization? Sometimes we think about process of a colonization and settlers as something of the past, but the truth is that they keep unfolding into today. I think as storytellers, as artists, as people who produce images and therefore builds knowledge through those images and is influencing people's visions and understandings, there is a very strong way we can contribute to the construction of historical memory.
I'm Elizabeth Hoover. I am an associate professor in the Environmental Science Policy Management Department at UC Berkeley. The first book that I wrote was called The River Is In Us, Fighting Toxics in a Mohawk Community, that focuses on environmental health research that the community did with field workers from the community. While I was there, I started volunteering with this group called Gunahio Yungoya Dohage, or We Are Planting Good Seeds, working to get people back into farming and gardening and seed saving and eating local produce. That led me to wonder, how are other community-based organizations in other tribal communities doing this work? So I started attending these different food sovereignty summits that have been popping up over the last decade or so. Traveled 20,000 miles around the country and went to 40 different communities and asked people, you know, what are some of the successes and challenges that you're having and facing? How are you defining food sovereignty for your community? How do you center control over a food system with the food producers and the consumers, as opposed to these multinational corporations who really control the food systems now? And how do you prevent that environment from becoming contaminated through other people's bad ideas? The reason why there's such a push now and a movement to reclaim food sovereignty is because the settler colonial system here has intentionally targeted indigenous food systems for destruction for the purposes of political domination. You go from a diet of a lot of meats, vegetables, berries, fruits, to not being fed enough and being fed foods that were very different. And it's not like people had a lot of time to pack up all of their seeds and their materials. You know, people were rounded up and forced on a death march. People got to a new space, to a very different landscape, to and not having their tools and their seeds with them. And so again, had to adapt to what foods were available, what foods were given to them, and are now having to consciously work to reclaim these seed varieties and these kinds of foods. Working to reclaim health is a very political act when the health of your community has been intentionally targeted for destruction. So taking those ideas around control over food and agriculture systems, how do we instead localize food systems so that they all look a little different and are controlled by the local communities and are reliant on foods that will do well in those local spaces? How do you remedy health through taking control over these food systems? Wild rice is a really important foodstuff for Indigenous people in the Great Lakes area. For people who go out and gather this wild rice, who take their canoes and their knockers, these two big sticks, and go out and they bend the heads of the rice over and tap it, and somebody in the back of the canoe will kind of push the canoe along. So it's a particular skill that's passed down, you know, through communities, through families, and along the way you have all of these specialists who are making their living for the year. When tribal nations signed treaties with the United States, it was often with the understanding that people would still have the right, insured through law, to gather traditional foods in these spaces. And those rights are being threatened by the potential of those spaces becoming contaminated. It's a really sensitive plant. It requires a certain amount of very clean water. And so if those waterways are contaminated, that plant dies and it's very hard to bring it back. It's really difficult to reclaim chemical pollution or oil or other petrochemicals. Pipelines are being touted as a more efficient way to get oil to places where that oil is then refined and often shipped to other places around the world. The concerns is that pipelines leak. It's not like, oh, if this pipeline leaks, it's when and where it's going to leak. And you have to decide whose property do you put a pipeline over. And so companies feel that they can route these pipelines through these spaces that are blank on maps and left intentionally blank on maps. It's like, oh, here's all this empty space up here. We're just going to run the pipeline over the space that looks very empty on the map, but which on the ground is a very important habitat for wild rice and where native communities are out in spaces insured through treaties gathering food. I mean, leaving something blank can be an act of cartographic violence, right? Deciding what goes onto the paper and is deemed as worthy of being mapped and what spaces get left blank. To the outside viewer, it's like, oh, it's a map. It's very objective, right? This is just showing me where things are. But a lot of power goes into deciding what is put on that map, what is brought attention to, what is deemed as worthy of mapping out there. A big part of the activism of these Indigenous water protectors and allies has been to make very visible to the public, you know, what does it look like when a big scar is cut through the earth to put these pipelines in? What does it look like after they're leaking? What does it look like when people go to resist those and are then pepper sprayed and beat up by the police? It has taken Indigenous leadership, but also other allied communities that recognize that these are terrible projects and are not worth permanent environmental destruction. When it comes to how does the architectural community figure out how to be better allies, there's not going to be one big be an ally to the world answer. It's going to be what do the communities in your region want and need, and it's going to look a little different in every different place depending on the communities there and the settler colonial history that those communities have had to navigate and face and rebound from. You know, allyship is important. Allyship that follows Indigenous leadership is even more important, and that takes as many numbers as possible.
So good afternoon, everyone. Good evening. Buenos dias. My name is Macarena Gomez Barris, and I come to you from Lenape Hoking territories in Brooklyn, New York. And I'm excited today to be in conversation with Carolina Caycedo and Elizabeth Hoover. You just saw two short films based on their work. And I wanted to take a few minutes before our conversation to open the panel, since I think we have some common themes across our work. And I myself am a researcher. I've written on these themes and the extractive zones, social ecologies, and decolonial perspectives, as well as in other writings. I think some of the commonalities include discussing histories of colonialism and modernity that erase indigenous land rights and practices, and certainly the colonization of waterways, as both of you described in those short pieces, the building up of extractive infrastructures, and how, I think Elizabeth said this, the bad ideas, right, of colonial. We can think of oil pipelines and dams, how they continue to devastate local, small, and artisanal agriculture, and of course, pollute the ground and toxify the waterways. These are key issues of our times, of course. I think another commonality is the effort through our writing, our research, through visual arts, through activism, to really center indigenous voices and what I often call submerged perspectives, that effort to make visible those who are working against the violence of settler colonialism, and who are working, for creating another kind of world, beyond the divide of the genocidal practice of settler colonialism. I wanted to mention that in the recent turn to decolonize everything, which is really important actually, but it's sometimes forgotten what the non-Indigenous Australian scholar Patrick Wolfe described as the logic of elimination, or that settler colonialism is a system, right? It's rather than any single historical event. And it's a system meant to perpetuate the erasure of Native peoples as a precondition for settler expropriation of lands and resources. That has to be central to our discussions when we talk about settler colonialism or coloniality, and also the decolonization. So I also think it was really interesting to me to see in the short films about each of your work, and you pointed to this, that there are many tools, maybe Audre Lorde would call them the master's tools, right, that are sometimes placed at the service of settler colonialism and the logic of elimination. You know, there are these narratives of growth, or maybe excessive and overgrowth. There are the tools of mapping. Carolina, you talked about surveying with David. There's, of course, the obliteration of indigenous histories and long genealogies of cultural memory. And there's also this practice of seeing the land as surplus rather than seeing it as a living entity. The practices, of course, of monoculture and its industry, and the interest, as Elizabeth's work explores, of, you know, agribusiness or big business over community autonomy, indigenous sovereignty, over good food and clean water. So I wanted to begin by just putting this on the table, that we know, of course, that each of these tools is not in themselves contaminated, but they've been weaponized and put at the service of dispossession and immiseration, especially for Indigenous and Black peoples in the US, but also globally. And given that we were invited here, and thank you for inviting us, Guggenheim and the organizers, we're invited to think also about architecture. Of course, we can deploy architecture and design to service and extend the project of colonial capitalism, or potentially to redesign our food and healthcare systems so that communal sovereignty is at the center. And then the last point I wanted to make about the kind of commonality across our bodies of work, I think, is with respect to the question of indigenous land and water defense, or land and water protection of territories and of waterways. And I wanted to just remind us all that, of course, it's important to place Standing Rock protests that were led by Sioux peoples and the Coalition of Strong Alliances at the center. And this was important because it increased visibility and support for deoccupation, we might call it. But I also wanted to say it's an important event because it's important to consider that it's these ongoing uprisings, mobilizations, and acts of protection of Madre Tierra, of Pachamama, of Mother Earth throughout the Americas continually since the 15th century. So with that really all as background, those several points as background, I wanted to start with you, Carolina, and the work that you made with David in the body of work that is part of the Blessings of Mystery exhibitions in West Texas, but also the new feature film that is in post-production, Blessings of Mystery, with the same title. And I wondered, you know, if it's true that we are thinking about putting indigenous or submerged perspectives at the center of our work, can you say something about the work you did, the process with Juan Mancias, who is described as the chairman of the Carrizo and Comecrudo tribe of Texas, but also I think there was something like 20 other voices you mentioned. So if you could just talk about that process and your thinking, that would be wonderful in that new feature film.
Hi, everyone. Thanks for connected. Really honored to be here with Elizabeth and with Maca in conversation today. I always say that Juan found us, and you know, that there was a strong desire and willing, you know, for us to connect to Southwest Texas. And we were trying to do our best through research and field work. But of course, you know, as somebody that's new to a place, you always hit a wall. And then Juan found us. And he literally found us. He came to give a talk to Boyle Heights, where we lived at the moment, in a community center called La Concha on Cesar Chavez, East Cesar Chavez Avenue, that La Concha is not there anymore. And I became aware that he was giving a talk about these villages that the Carrizo Comecrudo were establishing along the Rio Grande Valley to stop border fence construction during the past administration. And so at the moment we had already done a field trip to Texas to conduct field work, to research some archives. And so of course I attended the talk and that's how we connected with Juan. So he came to Boyle Heights and we continued in conversation. We visited him and also visited different sites with him and visited his cultural center in Floresville close to San Antonio, participated of some special ceremonies like bird dance that they conduct as a way to connect not only on the research level and the things that we were interested to, but accepting also that invitation to come to his place where his family lives and practices. The first thing that really blew my mind from the conversation that Juan gave during the La Concha talk was that he explained and gave a version, or not a version, let's say an interpretation of the Lower Pecos rock art that we mentioned in the video that was totally opposite of what the academic interpretation is that comes out of a group of people who are doing an excellent job in 3D and scanning and preserving with all their best intentions this Lower Pecos rock art that is we're losing that rich history and memory because it's in private land, because they're not taken care of, because of, you know, climate change effects, natural erosion, whatnot. And so the Carrizo Comecrudo understand this language as prophecies of things that are happening today, from the arrival of the white man to the establishment of the oil industry, cattle and oil industry in Somisec, which is their territory, Texas, and means the land of the sun. Actually, it's both sides of the Rio Grande or Rio Bravo, not only Texas. And it's also prophecies of urban establishment and urban growth and gentrification as we understand it today. So of course, nothing close to what we had read and investigated about these paintings, which the most important one is known as the White Shaman, which if you think about the name is already quite offensive, right? The White Shaman. For the Carrizo, the White Shaman is actually prophesizing the arrival of the white man to Somisek. And so just to, you know, like that small talk, and he was just, you know, kind of giving context of that to speak about the processes of land liberation, as we call them in Colombia, liberación de la madre tierra, when you actually enter a space, establish, you know, yourself there in encampments or what, to stop something that's destroying that place, right? So the Carrizo were establishing villages along the Rio Grande Valley in locations where actually their traditional village had been at some point, the most important Jalui village called Butterfly Village, very close to the Butterfly National Center that has also been impacted by the construction of the wall. And from the Carrizo, we also learned and understood that the wall infrastructure and the border between the United States and Mexico is not only a security infrastructure, it's actually an oil infrastructure and a water infrastructure. Because the way the wall is constructed, there's the grazing of almost a mile from both sides of the wall of any sort of vegetation. And this is, becomes a militarized portion of land with all sorts of armed militias, DEA, ICE, Texas Rangers, even paramilitary private militias, private groups that go armed out there, all sorts of surveillance devices. Some of them that are included that you could actually see in the wall paintings from 4,000, 2,000 years ago in the Lower Pecos. And of course, this is the perfect place to run pipelines, to run oil infrastructure, and to also kind of take over and hoard water pumps and water valves that, you know, irrigate the Rio Grande Valley crops and stuff. So Juan really opened our eyes, taught us a lot. The Carrizo Comecrudo tribe are, you know, leading right now different struggles in Southwest Texas, border construction, construction of pipelines, you know, using all means they have, from, you know, this literally putting themselves on the front lines, being arrested for civil disobedience, to suits of all types, you know. Also supporting now, you know, Texas is also housing the new with all the SpaceX happening, so, you know, this further frontier into space, if you wish. But anyways, just to wrap up and hand over the word, it was definitely a blessing to find Juan, or that Juan found us and kind of brought us under the wing of the Carrizo and taught us so many things and allowed us to align ourselves with their struggles down there.
Yes. I mean, I'm struck by so many things of your response, in part that the butterflies, of course, have no border, but maybe they can't fly as high now as the border is made, right? So that's interesting, but also the rivers often that are diverted or polluted precisely because of the border that cuts them off. And both of you have worked extensively on rivers. And for Elizabeth, I mean, in the past, your book, The Rivers in Us, is such a beautiful title. And it reminds me actually of a saying by a group that Carolina's worked with in Southwestern Cauca, Colombia, you know, about we're not just living by the river, we are the river. So this idea of this breakdown between the human and non-human, or this other modality. But in your past work, you've discussed in that book in particular the material effects of industrial contamination, specifically for the Mohawk community of Akwesasne in upstate New York. And I know that you've worked on indigenous food sovereignty in the United States on a volume with Devin Mihe-Swa. I hope I'm saying Devin's last name okay. And currently are working on a wonderfully titled From Garden Warriors, Indigenizing the Local Food Movement under, is that the full title, Indigenizing the Local Food Movement?
Yes, because from garden warriors to good seeds, indigenizing the local food movement.
Okay, something got a little bit stuck there in mind. Wonderful title. So I wonder if you could speak a little bit how you do research in your work. I know you're an academic, you're a scholar, of course, you're a writer, you're from some of these communities. If you could just speak about your practice of course, foregrounding Indigenous peoples first and those issues.
Yeah, so I started working on that first book, The River Is In Us, while I was a graduate student. And so I was working on a degree in anthropology, and I was visiting with a Mohawk midwife named Gudgie Cook, who is a fantastic scholar, activist, midwife, everything. You know, she's an amazing human being. And she had been at the center of, in previous decades to when I was visiting with her, reshaping how environmental health research was done in the community of Akwesasne. So this is a Mohawk community that's bisected by the US-Canadian border, so a different kind of border that's militarized in its own way. But industry had really set up along this river after it was widened and deepened, and then hydroelectric plants brought in some more of these infrastructures of violence that Carolina references in her film there. But brought in specifically to create this hydroelectric power to then attract industry that then contaminated the water and the air for people living right downstream, which was the Mohawk community, is the Mohawk community. They're still there, even as many of those industrial plants have closed up with the shifting of the economy. But when it was discovered that General Motors had been leaching PCBs into the St. Lawrence River, Gudgie became concerned about what did that mean for their food source? What did that mean for the women whose babies she was delivering, who she was encouraging to breastfeed? And so the quote for the title of the book, The River Is In Us, came from when she had her own breast milk tested. And she said, look, you know, I found out I have this many parts per million PCBs and Myrex and all of these other contaminants. And it was like, okay, so we know intuitively and culturally, but now scientifically, that when the river is polluted, so are we, you know, the river is in us. The contamination from the factory is now in the river and it's in us. So getting people to recognize that interconnection on a physical level that is scientifically quantifiable, in addition to having this cultural relationship with this river. So my project was really looking at the legacy of this community rising up and saying, we're going to do science differently here. So there, instead of, you know, Gudgie and the women that she was working with recognized that they were going to need science to demonstrate what they already knew, that this river was polluted, that the pollution was getting into people's bodies and it was impacting people's health. And so they partnered with the State University of New York at Albany and with the state environment divisions and health divisions to bring up scientists to help with this work, but also demanded that they had Mohawk women that were hired as data collectors, as people who were out collecting the samples, who were then kind of dictating some of the questions that were being asked by this research. And then also thinking about the collateral impacts of environmental contamination. So there are all these health studies that were done that demonstrated that higher levels of PCBs in people's bodies led to a number of different health conditions. But then also what happens when people are told like, oh, you shouldn't eat the fish. And, you know, maybe your gardens aren't so safe either if you're living near these industrial plants. So people stop farming, they stop fishing. They don't have a bunch of money all of a sudden to go out and buy nice food like they had been growing and gathering themselves. So there's a real shift of diet that then leads to other health impacts that then the community had to organize around trying to address some of those issues. And that's what led me to this second book project of thinking about how are other communities working to address these food systems issues, especially through community-based gardening and farming projects. So I went from working with one group very closely in Akwesasne called Gunahio Yungwaya Dohage, or We Are Planting Good Seeds. So that's part of where the title for the new book comes from, is the effort of all of these Mohawk farmers and gardeners and seed keepers working to organize together and try to get people, more people excited about growing food and harvesting food. And then wondering how are other communities working to address this? And that's what led to this current projects, the From Garden Warriors to Good Seeds, I took to the road and drove 20,000 miles around the country and interviewed people in 40 different communities to find out more about these issues, how other tribal communities are addressing these things. So I've gone on for a long time, but yeah, I've spent a lot of time in gardens. So that a lot of my method is weeding alongside people, sorting seeds, butchering chickens, whatever it is that people are working on as part of their food projects. So kind of not just trying to show up with pen and paper and, you know, take what I need and leave, but to also stay and contribute the kind of labor that they might be looking for.
Well, I mean, I think this is, thank you for explaining that. And I think in both of your practices, there's this attention to daily life and attention to the way in which people live their daily lives, and to actually render that in complex ways, one has to be, a kind of alongside rather than extracting information from, right? So I think that's really important. I hear that in both of your practices. I wanted to return to the comment that I mentioned at the opening about the master's tools or these tools, and even something like the scientific approach or Western scientific approach or data collection, or in your work, Elizabeth or Carolina has talked about mapping as a colonial tool, right? These ways that there are either, there are other ways to engage these strategies. There are other ways to think about how to put these tools to the service of potentially some other kind of end. So I wondered if you could talk about either counter mapping, Carolina, how you see that work, what I'd call research otherwise, or ways of even working. Yeah, sometimes it's as if it's a more purist model of decolonization that's floating out there sometimes, right? Where it's as if we have to throw out the baby with the bathwater, but in fact, to engage a scientific community, to engage certain kinds of expertise, to engage coalitional work or certain kinds of tools may in fact be important to these various struggles. So I wondered if you could speak on that, both of you.
Well, in this particular body of work, and in the feature film that we are producing now, we keep a critical stance, not so much provide kind of other counterways to utilize these tools. And we decided to do that precisely because we're speaking about the Southwest and how it continues to exist in the imaginary of people in a very particular way. And because, as I said, it's kind of the gateway now to other sort of surveying of the space now, right? With all this rich tycoons launching their rockets out into space. But also, from academic points with the establishment of the observatory in Fort Davis, for example. So if you think about Fort Davis as a gateway to the West, that was a military post, and right, you're standing there in that historical park. Now it's a national, a federal park, and you look up into the mountains, and there's the observatory. Right, it's like this outpost into the universe. But I think it's important to, when you do counter mapping, and it's possible to do it, and it's even possible to do it with the tools of the master. And I think folks like forensic architecture are a great example of how you position yourself and from where to position the use of these tools, not that is not for profit, but is actually to hold accountable perpetrators of violence. For the blessings of the mystery, we are kind of dissecting the way, the Homestead Act function to bring the United States out of bankruptcy after the Civil War, and to displace and dispossess indigenous peoples who ended up in places like Oklahoma, for example. And how, through oil industry, eminent domain practices today, this colonization continues to unfold in Texas, specifically with the construction of pipelines, LNGs, out into the coast, along the borderline, along very vulnerable ecosystems and communities. There is the drawing that we did do that is in the film, if you saw some color pencil images of a large drawing that we call Somisek. And we consider that as a way of counter mapping, of course, you know, using the tool of what is considered like a kid's tool, right? Color pencils, but put in a lot of love into bringing different things and different stories and different time periods into this representation and kind of portraying of Somisek. You know, I use the word portray to portray the land. For me, it's more useful, and I was ranting against landscape in the video precisely, but to portray the land, right? How can you portray a place? How can you portray a river? And for that, you have to be there and to stand there and to, you know, gather the wild rice or do what Elizabeth does, you know, bend your back and you know, smell the earth. And so I think, you know, we have to start rethinking the way that we, as artists, for example, that we produce visual texts, the way we refer to nature through our visuals, right? Rethink this colonial formats as landscape that puts us out of the natural kind of web of relationships that conform a territorial land. And actually, you know, through the process of representing and portraying a place, how that process of portraying actually embeds us in this place. I guess for Elizabeth, a little bit, that's through writing, right? And through speaking with the people. For us with David, in that particular drawing was through the drawing of those images that capture images from the past, but images of the rock paints that catapult us into the future too, because they're prophecies, right, into today's. I think a map needs to be able to connect us with the past, with the future, with what is above us, but what is below of us too.
Thank you for that, Carolina. Elizabeth, did you want to?
Yeah, I mentioned briefly in the video about how the way that pipeline companies depict these spaces is just these blank squares on maps that you can just run a line through. And that's a big part of where the effort of organizations like Honor the Earth that organize these pipeline rides to ride horses across the spaces where those pipelines would go as a way of bringing imagery to the broader public of this is the space where this pipeline goes. This is the wild rice lake that will be contaminated. And that was for the Sandpiper pipeline in 2014. And now ongoing efforts to resist line three as they continue to dig in the ground, dig under waterways. There are many water protector camps set up trying to draw attention to these spaces, to these exact waterways, because these very sterile maps, as you've described, don't give any indication of what that landscape actually looks like and what it actually means to the people living there.
Great. So I have one last question, and then maybe some concluding thoughts for each of you. And maybe we'll start with Elizabeth, since this comes in part from your discussion of allyship that was brought up in the film, which I think is so critical. Some of us call it being a comrade or being an ally to Indigenous peoples, the Red New Deal that has been put forward by the Red Nation recently talked also about the importance of Indigenous leadership at the forefront of addressing these questions, and you put that so well. In each of your work, how do you think that operates? I mean, and if there are any kind of, I don't want to say advice, but maybe advice for other artists, scholars, activists, thinkers, students out there who are really wanting to do this work. I know at Pratt, when I work with students, they all ask me how do we do this work? We know we can diagnose these issues. We now have the critical tools. What are some of the next steps that we can take? So I have my own take on that, but I'd love to hear from you first, Elizabeth, how you see that operating in your work, or what you would say, and then Carolina, thank you.
Yeah, I mean, the bit in the video was kind of in response to the cameraman had asked me right before they were packing up, kind of the, you know, what can architects do? And my response was the problem is that I can't just give you a blanket solution. There is no blanket solution to anything. And it reminded me of, you know, a lot of times when I'm giving talks about, you know, the native food sovereignty movement and seed sovereignty movement and these efforts in communities to reclaim and relocalize horticulture, agriculture. And there's always somebody who stands up, you know, usually an engineer or somebody of the sort and says, but how are we going to feed the world? Like, these ideas are really cute. This is really nice, but how are we going to feed the world? And I'm always asking, who's the we who's going to feed the world? You know, how's that worked out so far when, you know, organizations like the US have been like, oh, here, we're just going to grow all the stuff and dump it on you and you're welcome, have some food. It hasn't worked well. And so, you know, the problem is not necessarily that there, if you look at the global production of food, that there's not enough food. It's an issue of distribution and community control and localization. And so how do we localize food systems? And that takes, you know, handing over control and decisions and land back, give it back to, you know, the people who have been unfairly ousted from these spaces. But it's about, you know, relocalizing food systems, relocalizing control over things. And there's a role and a position for allies, for people with resources, whether they be monetary resources or intellectual resources or resources of time. But it takes people with those resources approaching communities and community organizations and saying, what do you need? As opposed to, you know, so often I have students from different programs on the country, these social entrepreneurship companies, and they'll write to me and they'll say, I came up with this great project. Who can I take this to? Who can I drop my project on? It's like, well, you've gone all backwards with it. If you've developed the project and now you're just trying to figure out where to plug it into, you know, what you should do is say, okay, here's my skill set. Here's what I have. Here's what I'm good at. Here's what I'm interested in. How does that align with what the community needs, and collaboratively develop these kind of projects that way, so that you're developing using more of a Venn diagram of what does the community need and what do I have to offer and where do those overlap and how can we develop a project accordingly, rather than I've developed this neat thing, who can I drop it on?
Wonderful, thank you, Carolina.
I totally echo Elizabeth, and it's, you know, it's time for us to recognize Indigenous leadership, to also honor that they've been in the front line of all sorts of struggles for so long, you know, and now all these struggles want to get dumped into a single, again, colonizer term that we call climate change, climate justice, which has so many, you know, threads and particularities. So we should be attentive, you know, as people who use words and images, how we are using those words and images to Juan, the Carrizo Come Crudo tribe is non-federally recognized tribe, non-state recognized tribe. You know, Indigenous knowledge has historically been stigmatized and pushed to the side, and more if there's no federal recognition. There's, you know, they don't even have land as people in reservations. So it's time to recognize and to open the space and to transfer resources and to give land back, for sure. And to leave our aesthetic, intellectual goals in a second position, and again, understand and ask, what are your needs? That's, you know, what Elizabeth said is the first step. What are your needs? What do you need? How can I support your agendas? How can I, you know, walk along you and support, you know, what your goals are? So, very echo a lot what Elizabeth just said beautifully.
I think what you both are also pointing to is the need. Certainly our institutions come out of long histories of colonialism as well, right? And higher education does as well. So the need to really transform disciplines. I mean, there are a lot of tools to be taken from the disciplines, but how to also think about putting those at the service of community needs and the ways that you both just outlined. So thank you very much. I wonder if you have any final words or anything that you want to point our audience to in your practices or in your writing, and then we'll close. Any final words?
I want to invite you next week. We will have a live podcast from UT Austin. I think it's the 27th and the 28th. Also a live or streamed roundtable with Juan Mancias and some scholars at UT Austin with the head of the Texas Archaeological Research Lab, Fred Valdez, and Professor Marta Menchaca from UT Austin in the context of the exhibition. So if you are curious about the blessings of the mystery, about Juan, what Juan, you know, has to say and whatnot, please connect. And it's all on the website of the Visual Arts Center.
Great. Elizabeth, did you have any final words?
I don't think so. Thank you all for joining today. And I just encourage folks to find out whose land you're on. And, you know, there was a great report that came out recently about land grab universities and looking at how universities like UC Berkeley, where I'm currently employed, really benefited from the theft of land from Indigenous communities and the sale to other settlers. So yeah, I encourage people to find out whose land you're on and, you know, what can be done to support those people.
So important what you both are saying, in part because we're so complicit or imbricated. These systems are so imbricated in ways, complex systems, right? And cultural institutions, academic institutions, et cetera. So yes, land-based knowledges, wonderful, and practices. Thank you both. It's been a pleasure to be in conversation with you today. And thank you to the Guggenheim. We really appreciate the time. And thank you all for joining us. Have a wonderful rest of your day. Thank you.
Thank you so much for all of you for listening, for speaking with us in the chat today, for participating. It's been an incredibly illuminating day. And to our speakers and our panelists, thank you for your challenges, for your questions, for your arguments, and for creating this space today for all of us to think in new and different ways about these really important issues of architecture, equity, land, space, sovereignty, voice, story. I'd also love to announce that you don't have to worry, there will be more to come. This really wonderful and fruitful partnership with the world around will continue as a result of our residency. We will be co-hosting together next year's January-February summit, the beginning of the year. We hope you stay tuned. We hope you continue to follow and to participate in the dialogues that we're having with each other and with you. And again, we thank you. And with that, my tremendous gratitude to Beatrice and the world around for being such incredible partners and for making this dialogue possible.
Thank you, Syra, and thanks everybody for watching. And again, this is the last event of our residency with the Guggenheim, which has been such a fantastic relationship and collaboration with the Public Programs Department. And we are so happy to be coming back next year with our annual summit. So once again, thank you, Renee, Joseph, Emmanuel, Holly, Simon, Louisa, Carolina, Elizabeth, and Macarena for all of your effort, your wisdom, your creativity, and thank you to the World Around team. Thank you to the World Around Board of Directors and Trustees and our partners, our global partners, Facebook, Open Arts, and Amura. We are so happy to have been here. We hope you have a great weekend, and we'll see you in the new year.
See you next year.